check in. Check them in. All right, so we got our dock assignments around back. Let's go, let's just open our doors up around back. I don't want to open them up all the way out here. We got to go completely around the whole building. And, they could be better to... If we open up the doors now, there's a chance they could pop loose, and I'll tell you a sad story. When I was running up to Canada all the time, getting loaded at a place in Canada, and the driver next to me was telling me a story, you know, because the company required us to, the shipper, to open our doors, and then we would drive around the building. When you first enter the complex, you get weighed on the incoming, they weigh your empty, then you go around and they get your printout of your weights, and then they load you maximum weight. They're trying to get as close to 80,000 pounds as they can get. So you open your doors, you get on the scale, or you get on the scale, open your doors, go around to get loaded, and you're driving with your doors open for, you know, a little distance to get over to the docks, and then around over to the other, you leave your doors open to get on the outbound scale, and if they determine that you can take more weight, they will actually back you off the scale, you know, 20 feet, get you off the scale, and throw another load on you, another bale on you. 45 is down here. You guys want to blindside in? There's two spots wide on this river, but I think it's going to be... I'm trying to think. I don't know if there's enough room to turn around. Five is right here. Yeah, there's two spots right here. Two spots wide. I can hit two spots wide. What you do is you just aim for the middle between the two spots and just kind of get it tucked in there, and then do your pull-ups and get straight, whatever you gotta do. All right, let's go open our doors. You guys wanna come with and help? Help me, help me. Help me, help me. And should be a super light load. It's only like 4,300 pounds. I'm not certain that I need to slide the tenons back, but if we do, we're gonna wait till we get it deeper into the dock to do that, because when you're all the way back, it takes a country mile to just turn this, swing this trailer into that hole right there. And these particular door handles have a tendency to pop out. They're not, they don't, you know, you gotta tie wire them in or whatever. I like to tie wire, rope them in. But I don't, evidently they don't need it. Evidently they have no tie, no wires hanging, no twine, no nothing hanging, which means that the drivers haven't had a problem with it. They've not had a problem with it, so that's good news. So I'm gonna put the camera over here. Put it right here and we can watch the whole show. I think right here. Good. Don't overheat, man. Blindside in right there. Pretty good on the line, huh? What do you think? Blindside back in Scotty's Kills. Okay, I hear the gate going up. Fleet. It's already up, dude. Shouldn't take long at all, dude. I said chalk the wheels. Let me do that real quick. Alright, so that's pretty good. One small pull up for mankind, one giant leap for the moon. I don't know. Poor little palm tree is gonna get pushed out by the pine tree eventually, Monterey pine tree. And the oleanders, check them out. Pretty. Alright, so they're expecting me to be in Portland, Oregon tomorrow. This is Livermore, California. I'm expected to arrive in noon tomorrow in Portland, which is not likely gonna happen. I'll have to check my GPS and see what she thinks. But I used to be leased to a company over there. We had a terminal here in Livermore, right around the corner, a couple miles away maybe. And many, many times the company would call me, because we were on paper logs in those days. And the company would, I'd get a call from somebody in the office, hey, I got a load to, Seattle, Portland, Seattle. First stop, Portland. Second stop, Seattle thing, you know, Sumner, Washington. And they were like, I think you can be in Portland in the morning. We'll get you loaded at midnight tonight. I need you down there by 10 a.m. in the morning or something. Noon in Portland. I go, well, it's more than 11 hours legal drive time to get there. From Livermore to Portland is like 600... I'd have to look on Google Maps, but it's 600 and something miles. More than 11 hours, because in those days, Oregon was 55 speed limit, along with California is always 55. So 55 times 11 is 555, 605, I think, something like that. I gotta do the math. And it was like a little more than 600 miles to Portland. So I mean, the math doesn't jive out, or jibe out, G-I-B-E, doesn't jibe out. Legally, so you would have to be forced to speed in order to make that load on time, which is, and the green book says the company cannot force you to run over your hours and or speed in order to make the load on time. You're protected by that. And I would say, no, I can't legally do that. Are you testing me? She goes, no, I'm not testing you. We got other drivers that do it all the time. Just curious, those drivers are not available, can you do it? And I'm like, no, I can't. I'm not gonna do it this time. I'll do it voluntarily all day long, but you don't tell me when I have to do this kind of thing. I, you know, owner operator. And if something goes wrong, of course, as an owner operator, I did not want to be on the hook for that liability. So I told them, there's too many witnesses, you know, that I didn't tell them that, but I basically, if they tell you to do something or ask you to do something, you agree to do something illegal, now you got a conspiracy. Now you got at least two people that know what the plan is to break the law. But if you're a truck driver and you voluntarily do it on your own, on your paper logs, and you exceed your hours and you exceed your speed, and you make that conscious choice to do those things, but nobody knows you did it. Under the auspices, the company will be like, when you sign the contract, they're like, you're gonna follow all the rules, regulations, laws of the road, and da-da-da, here's a green book, brand new green book to read, you know, the green trucker's Bible thing, regulations. And they're like, you agree to follow all the laws. And everybody knows it's truckers shine that stuff on. You see it every day. They're out there speeding, changing lanes without turn signals. They got 1 foot up on the dash while they're playing with their phone and they're in cruise control and they're going down a hill, triple digits, whatever. They're doing all kinds of stuff they're not supposed to be doing. Anyway, as long as you don't get caught, it doesn't count, does it? And they do that, especially with the ELDs now, the electronic logbooks. Truckers will speed to make up for the old days when they used to be able to run from, say, Livermore to Portland in one shot and get paid a little bonus. Now, I could have asked for, probably could have asked for extra money. I'd be like, hey man, I'll get it there overnight for you, but you gotta kick me like $500 extra, something like $1 a mile extra. I'll get it there overnight. And they probably would do it. But again, that adds to your conspiracy. And if something happens and you gotta go to court and you got a fatality crash and you gotta explain to the family of the deceased, you know, the load paid an extra $500 and we got into a crash and your loved one died. And that's not easily explained away. And I don't wanna be in that. I swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and I don't want to do that. I don't want a conspiracy. But many times I did do things on my own. As an owner-operator on paper logs, yes. I think my best day was 980 miles in a 24-hour period. There's no possible way that's legal. Unless you got you're driving in those 85-mile-per-hour states. Maybe, but not where I was. But you know, those days are long gone behind us, and in the way the electronic or any logging devices work in trucking, the login requirements, hours of service, anything more than 6 months ago doesn't count. It doesn't matter, because the green book says that the company will keep your logs 6 months back in the office. Truck's getting loaded. They'll keep your logs 6 months back in the office for in case something happens within the next 6 months, 180 days. A fatality crash, for example, the lawyers can go into the office and subpoena all your records and get them and look for patterns. They're looking for patterns, and truckers don't realize this. Truckers think, oh, I only have to keep 7 days of logs plus today, you know, the 8 day recap of my logbook on my ELD or my paper logs for my ELD. That's all I need to show the officer. But the company is keeping an electronic record of those all the way back to 6 months ago. And as they get 6 months and 1 day old, they delete them. And they're deleted from the universe. That's why I say it doesn't matter after 6 months. But what else? Wonder if they're gonna tell me it's done. But I don't know where we're going with that, except how did that start? We're talking about Livermore to Portland. Company wants me to be there. Let's just go check it out. Let's push the address in there real quick and see if see what the GPS thinks. Now, I went back to the old GPS for a reason. The new one is acting funny. Plug it in and it charges to 100%, it goes green. You know, the battery goes, the battery light turns green. Which would be indicative of, well, that's fine, it's a full battery, but it's plugged in, but it seems to only want to work on the battery. Like it only wants to run. I'm just gonna put in Jubitz truck stop, which is close enough. Jubitz travel center, let it calculate, you see that? It's right on.
Proceed
right
to the highlighted route.
655 miles. And tolls. Yes, use current route. I don't know if you can see it. It's kind of. I got it on the brightest setting. So it says 5:30 in the morning. If I left right now. So 5:30 in the morning plus a 10-hour break is 3:30 in the afternoon. So, like I said, didn't I already tell you that we were not going to make the noon appointment? So that's 3:30 in the afternoon minimum. We haven't even got finished loaded yet. Could take another half hour, so that's 6 in the morning. Then we got to do a pre-trip, that's 6:15. We got to get fuel, that's 6:30 in the morning. pre-trip fuel. Possibly got to pull over and use the restroom, or maybe yes, no, maybe we don't know about that. Maybe get a cup of coffee, maybe take a 30-minute break too. 650 miles, you got to take a 30-minute break. Number one, number two, number three, it's more than you can do an 11-hour shift. So 650 miles is going to require, well, it depends. I have, how many hours do I have right now? 4 hours and 2 minutes remaining right now. So let's say they get me out of here within the next hour and can run about perhaps 100 miles of that off today. That's still going to cause me to have to take a 10-hour break. So 555 miles between wherever I end up today to Portland is going to be a tall order because we have so many mountains to cross over. But the final 100 miles out of Northern California and the first 200 miles in Oregon are up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, curvy, curvy, up, down, up, down, up, down. It's a lot of mountains in that 300-mile stretch. But, like I said, if it's 4,300 pounds, we could probably climb those hills pretty fast. So, let's see. Still, like I said, 500 miles on flat ground for me, for this truck, it's a tall order. I mean, I have to run, in California, I have to be running 59 to 61 miles an hour, which is anywhere between 4 and 6 miles an hour over the speed limit on average between here and the border of Oregon. Then we're going to be climbing through Oregon. We're not going to be able to maintain a steady speed. You go downhill at 61, but you're going uphill at 47, whatever, averaging out lower than what you want. You know, it's just, I would say 5:30 in the morning, 3:30 in the afternoon. It's probably going to have to be, tomorrow's Tuesday. So I'm probably not going to be able to deliver this load till Wednesday morning, because it's due to the nature of the distance, time to distance ratio in the hills and everything else in the way, and the traffic right now. It's rush hour going east through Livermore over the Altamont Pass. Bumper to bumper traffic all the way to Stockton, California. I already know because I used to, trust me, for 19 years I used to commute from the Bay Area back to Stockton. I know. And what I used to do, if I were working in San Francisco, Oakland, San Jose, somewhere down there along, it's about 90, 100 miles back home. And I would get about over to the Altamont, and there was a pullover spot, where the truckers pulled over. I pull over my pickup truck, got a pillow, and I just kind of kick back and wait, let traffic thin out, take about an hour nap whenever I woke up, and I was moving. And finish going home, get my shower, set my alarm, and get up and do it again the next day. And I tell you, I do not miss those days. The commute tired me out more than the work. And the morning commute was good because I could leave about 3 in the morning. I'd have to get up earlier to beat the commute. Leave at 3 in the morning, arrive at my job around 5 in the morning, more or less. Put my blanket, a pillow, and just sleep until about 6:30 a.m. to make up for the sleep I lost because I had to get up extra early to get there. But my sleep is broken up all over the place. I sleep in my pickup truck in the morning. I take a nap before I go home, and then I get a shower and go to bed. I don't have any life, but I was making good money in those days. And I was grumpy, I was angry, I was mad all the time. And the weekend would come. And I was just like, all right, finally got the weekend. But I was mad because I would never get anything done. I was trying to catch up on all my rest. Sleep in on Saturday morning, and I'm like, I don't feel like doing anything today on my to-do list. I still got tomorrow Sunday to do it, and then Sunday I wouldn't get anything done, and I knew Monday was coming right quick, and I was going to be right back up again, going to the same place again, dealing with the same people again. And it was just a vicious, vicious, angry cycle, and I'm still kind of working it out. You know, I realize maybe I'm not such a, I don't project myself as a nice guy. I'm a nice guy, but I come off very rough because of my 19-year of working life that I was grinding out hours and working hard. No rest for the wicked. I think the last time I ever felt fully rested was Labor Day weekend, 1997. I was up with friends. We were camping up in the mountains, and I was so, so rested. I wanted to leave a little bit early. I left on Sunday night. They're like, we still got tomorrow's Monday as a holiday, you know? I'm like, I know, but I want to get home and lay around on my couch, watch TV, and kind of, I just want to, I don't want to fight traffic tomorrow on Monday afternoon when everybody else is on the freeway trying to get back where they, back to their grind. I said, I want to go home now. I want to go home early. And when I was on my way back, and then I heard on the radio Princess Diana thing, and I was like, because I had been, we didn't have internet back then. You didn't have smartphones. You didn't have access to the internet to see the news or whatever. And I was cut off from the world. I was up the mountains camping for 3 solid days straight. We left on Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Probably left Friday morning early. I got up there Friday, set up camp. Party all day, Friday night, Saturday night, and Sunday I went home. And I was going to have a day off at home for myself. Wreck. That was the last time I ever felt truly, truly rested. It's been pushing close. It'll be 25 years. I mean, this is crazy. 26. Alright, he says we are done. Let's go. Close our doors just to triple make sure that nothing falls out. Plus we don't have to do it in the sunlight. The sun blasting down on you like a freaking furnace. Nice light load. It should be well, I don't know what it is. It's all wrapped in plastic. That's what I was afraid of. See, the top one isn't going in, and you got to do some fancy two-handed deal to get it slapped up in there. There it is. So simple. They're probably going to want to put a seal on it, so I will not put my lock on it yet. Ooh. Nice breeze, man. Missed the top again. There it is. Let them put a seal on it. And then I'll lock it after the seal. Be good to go, man. little bit big and you're a little bit obvious. And we don't need to be answering questions. What is that? Are you filming? Or you know, we don't need those kind of questions asked. So I will just go check in, get my paperwork signed for them. They might want to see ID. Maybe. We'll be right back. Stay cool. Gave me just one copy of the bill, so I have to go to the truck stop and get another copy. Meanwhile, they do have a fountain in there. I'm gonna fill up my 1 gallon jug. Stick them back in the fridge. We got a 3 gallon of water, man. This is the commute I was telling you guys about. Today's only Monday, but you should see it on a Friday, especially on a Thursday before a 4-day weekend. Going eastbound towards Stockton. Oh my God, we're on the Altamont, the beginning of the Altamont. Leaving Livermore, Livermore, Livermore. This is what you end up with. Ridiculous. Inching along, bumper to bumper. Nobody on the CB. Hello, hello, we got a copy. Sorry for this Tesla. I hope he has enough juice to weather this traffic jam. He's sitting there at 102 degrees trying to keep cool and trying not to run out of battery. And it's got to be frustrating. Since they only have like a 300 mile range, and you got to wonder, is it how much charge is on there? Got a copy? I got a report. Hit 11 vehicles up here. It's 12 total vehicles sprawled out, blocking all lanes. About a mile ahead too.